When you look at the Word of God, don't miss the little things. God has a purpose for saying what He does in the Word. And life in the Holy Spirit, life in Christ, is not complicated. I think sometimes we make it complicated. Perhaps people listen to a lot of different teachings, they have different models, and they become confused and they think they have to be some special person or gifted or whatever. But when you look at the Word of God, just everything is simple. The Word was made, was written for fools.
Thank you, Lord.
People like me. You know, it wasn't written for brilliant people. It was written that we can understand it. When you think how wise God is. So when we approach the Word, we approach it with a spirit of humility, and God's not trying to impress us. He doesn't need to, with how wise he is. He speaks simple things. When you enter into the simple things of God, you enter into glory. There's two words that Jesus said in the Synoptics, that's Matthew, Mark, Luke, and the Gospel of John, two words that he repeatedly said that are so profound. He said them at the beginning of his ministry, in the Gospel of John, he said them at the end of his ministry, to his disciples, to his apostles. Three words. What were they? Why were they so important? And then throughout his ministry, he said these three words again and again and again. And yet, when you're reading your Bible, it can be very easy to miss them. And these three words bring us into the depths of God. We ready? In John 12:26, Jesus says, "If anyone serves me, let him follow me." Three words, come, follow me. Let him follow me. "And where I am, there my servant will be also. If anyone serves me, him my Father will honor. And where I am, there my servant will be also." Ministry is about following Jesus and being where he is. That's pretty much it. It's about following Jesus. When you follow Jesus, you're following his commands. Do this, don't do that. When you're following Jesus, you're going where he goes. You're being with him. The servant, Jesus is the master. He expects the servant to be at his side. You with me?
Yes.
He expects the servant to be at his side, to be there waiting. And if the Lord says, do nothing, you do nothing. There's a little girl, about 12-year-old in New Zealand. She says, "I don't want to wear glasses." I said, "Okay, you believe that Jesus Christ will heal your eyes?" She said, "Yes." Jesus said to me, "Go away, Mark." So I walked across the other side of the room and she said, "I can see." It's just being with him and doing what he says,
yes,
and getting over yourself. Yes. You're not that important.
Right.
The important thing about the servant is the master he serves.
Yes.
Turn to the person beside you and say, the important thing about the servant is the master he serves. Jesus said of his servants, he said, "He who receives you receives me. And he who receives me receives the one who sent me." The important thing when someone receives us is they're receiving the Father who sent the Messiah. May we be like a sheet of glass that they just see Jesus straight through us. They don't stop at the... Maybe they'll walk straight into the glass. They don't see us. Amen? Praise God. You ready to go deeper? John 3, verse 5. Jesus answered, "Most assuredly I say to you, unless one is born of water and the Spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. That which is born of the flesh is flesh. That which is born of the Spirit is spirit. Do not marvel that I said to you, you must be born again. The wind blows where it wishes. You hear the sound of it, but you cannot tell where it comes from and where it goes. So is everyone born of the Spirit." When we're born of the Spirit of God, we become like a leaf blown by the wind. The Holy Spirit will blow you to follow Jesus like a leaf. And when you trust the Lord with your life, the leaf does not control where the wind blows it. The Holy Spirit is leading us to follow Jesus. He's blowing us life in the Spirit. Actually, the person who lives in the Spirit is a mystery to unbelievers because they cannot see the work of the Spirit. They cannot see the kingdom of heaven that is at work. They cannot see the invisible realm of the domain of Christ. They do not understand. Many will think, you need to have this job, you need to make money, you need to do this and this and this, but our lives are like a leaf being blown as we follow Jesus Christ. Sometimes doesn't make sense to other people. And you know, I think it's not always a good idea to explain yourself to unbelievers. Why not be a mystery? Why not be a mystery to people? Paul often talked about the mystery of the gospel, the mystery of Christ. If we are in Christ, you've got to be a mystery. Who can understand? Who can understand you if you're in Christ? You're born again, filled with the Holy Spirit, being led by the Spirit of God. Signs and wonders happening all around you. Amen. Turn to the person beside you and say, I am a mystery in Christ. Matthew 4, verse 18, Jesus walking by the Sea of Galilee saw two brothers, Simon called Peter and Andrew's brother. They were casting a net into the sea, for they were fishermen. And he said to them, follow me, and I will make you fishers of men. Fruitfulness in this life comes by not by having a ministry. Fruitfulness comes by following Jesus. He will do it. He will make us to do what he wants. I had a vision. Visions help us to understand the Word of God. That they shine light on the Word. They reveal the truth of God's Word. I had a vision. This vision can apply to anyone. The Lord is just talking to me about my life. So I'm in a vision and I'm seeing a heavenly corridor. I'm looking down this long hallway, and on either side of the hallway, there were large gift boxes, and they were wrapped and they all had a bow on the top, either side. And I see Jesus and I'm just with him and he's walking. And as he walks, I'm just hanging out with him. As he walks, his presence just opens the boxes and they all begin to open and the gifts are revealed. Blessings, gifts of the Spirit, healings, miracles. They're just happening. That's our life. We're just hanging out with Jesus and he has prepared a life full of gifts that shall be manifested in many, many people. And you're walking with him and bang, 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 they're manifesting like that. You're just with him. He's making you fishers of men. I thought that the gospel was trying to convert someone. But what I found was that when we walk with Jesus, there's good news exploding. Right. And happening, and lives are being changed and loved, and people are being converted. But it's not our effort, it's what he's doing, changing lives. Turn to the person beside you and say, today I'm going to walk with Jesus. Follow me and I'll make you fishers of men. Immediately they left their nets and followed him. In the book of that's in Matthew, but in the book of Mark, the word immediately is used again and again and again. Immediately, immediately. Many times people say, well, one day God will heal me. Immediately, immediately, immediately. Hallelujah. Going on from there, he saw two other brothers, James the son of Zebedee and John his brother, in the boat with Zebedee their father, mending the nets. He called them and immediately they left their boat and their father, and followed him. What did they leave? The boat and their father. He called them, and immediately. Everyone say immediately.
Immediately.
Turn to the person beside you and say immediately.
Immediately.
Immediately they left their boat and their father. We see it again in Matthew 9:9. Jesus passed on from there. He was just doing a journey, calling people into his ministry, you know.
Yeah.
So, he sees a man, Matthew, sitting at the tax office, and he says to him, what does he say?
Follow me.
Now, he sees sitting at the tax office. So he's probably got lots of money and, you know, on the table, people coming in with their coins and whatnot. And, you know, he's probably got a boss. Who knows? He said to him, follow me. So he rose, just left everything and followed him. Who's asking us to follow him? Us? Who's asking us to follow him?
Jesus.
The Master.
Yes.
God Almighty. It's not a normal invitation. There was a rich young ruler, Matthew 19:17. He comes to Jesus, good teacher, what good things shall I do that I may have eternal life? So Jesus begins to talk to him about the commandments. And he replies in verse 20, to Jesus, all these things I've kept from my youth, what do I still lack? Jesus said to him, if you want to be perfect, go, sell what you have, give to the poor, you'll have treasure in heaven, and come, follow me. Now, if we're following Jesus, there are activities that he won't do, that he won't participate in. One day I was watching what we would describe as a wholesome family video. And at the end of it, I turned off the TV and I had this most awful feeling, this terrible feeling. The room was empty of the glory. When I decided to watch that, that was not where he was going. A man comes to the meeting last year in North Carolina, Ohio, Dayton, Ohio, and he says, I've got prostate cancer. And the Lord says to me, you cannot pray for him until you ask him a question. I said to him, sir, do you go to church? He said, no, I can't say I go to church. I said, Jesus heals the body to save the soul. So will you follow Jesus? And he looked at me, and I thought about the rich young ruler. And he looked at me, and it was like I could see in his eyes that there was something that he was attached to, that was more important to him than being healed of cancer.
Wow.
So I said, well, think about it. He sat down looking miserable and got up and left. But when the young man heard that saying, he went away sorrowful, for he had great possessions. When Jesus calls you, he knows what you love. And you will have no gods before me. Idolatry is one of the worst sins of the Bible. It's mentioned again and again and again. You shall not make a graven image or any idol. And how we can make idols of things and people. Praise God. And you know, when he calls us, sometimes it means walking alone. sometimes it means walking alone. There may be people in your life who don't want to walk with you as you follow Jesus Christ and give him first priority. And sometimes there's real cost of relationships. He who loves father or mother more than me is not worthy of me. And he who loves son or daughter more than me is not worthy of me. And he who does not take his cross and follow after me is not worthy of me. He who finds his life will lose it. And he who loses his life for my sake will find it. I am the resurrection and the life. When we follow Jesus, we walk in life. Praise God.
Praise God.
So we see, you know, this theme of Jesus calling people to follow him. And when people wanted to follow him, he begins to teach them what it means to follow Jesus Christ. Luke 9:57. Now it happened as they journeyed on the road that someone said to him, "Lord, I will follow you wherever you go." Doesn't that sound great? Doesn't that sound good? I mean, probably everyone in the room would say the same thing. But when Jesus looks at you and you're talking to him, he's listening to your heart, not your lips. He's seeing what your heart beats for, what your heart is saying. "Lord, I'll follow you wherever you go." And Jesus said to him, "Foxes have holes and birds of the air have nests, but the Son of Man has nowhere to lay his head." So you get people who say, "Oh yeah, I'll follow Jesus. I'll say the sinner's prayer. I'll be a Christian." But do they really give their heart to him? Do they really follow him? And there are others that Jesus says, "Follow me." He said to another, "Follow me." And he said, "Lord, let me first go and bury my father." Let me first. When you follow Jesus, don't let him wait. Everyone say immediately.
Immediately.
Jesus said to him, "Let the dead bury their own dead, but you go and preach the kingdom of God." Sometimes there are things that happen in our life. They are dead things. They are things of the flesh. Let the dead bury their own dead. Let the dead things of the flesh look after themselves. But you go and preach the kingdom. You go and follow Jesus.
Amen.
One of the things I found in this ministry is that often there are distractions. Often there are distractions. And I know the priority must be the kingdom of heaven. You know, people can be offensive, they can say things can happen, you know, not even bad, like not sinful things, but things can happen. And you've got to keep your heart focused on the priority of the kingdom of God. I was reminded of the importance of the kingdom of following Jesus. I spoke in a church 3 years ago, and a man, young man, Matt, was sitting in the back of the meeting. And that afternoon, he was thinking, "I'll just take a knife and cut my jugular vein. It'll bleed. I'll bleed out in 30 seconds. I'll be dead." And he has a thought. "Go to church." He didn't know anything about my speaking. So he comes, he sits up the back. He was a drug addict since he was 11 years old. Crystal meth, had no money, no drugs. He said, "I'll just take my life." He sits up the back. The Lord locates him. But this was my third or fourth meeting and I was feeling very tired and I just didn't have the energy to pray for him. So he stands up. So the Lord locates two young women. I said, you go and pray for him. And he was completely delivered. His testimony is on YouTube. 3 years later, he shared this year of how he's got a lovely wife, he's baptized, goes to church, he's got a house, he's got a stable job. But, you know, if you get distracted, someone else might miss out on the blessing of God. You can't afford to focus on dead things. And we all have dead things that happen. A dead thing is when someone offends you. A dead thing is when someone wrongs you, and your flesh is provoked, and you want to react, and you want to let them have it. You want to deal with it. And it can be very difficult to let it go. To let it go. Because God has not called you to bury the dead. And there are things in all of our lives where we want to bury something. We want to deal with it. But do you love Jesus so much that you'll let it go? Let the dead body rot. Let the dead bury the dead. Let it deal with itself. And you're going to walk in love and forgiveness and get on with following Jesus Christ. God hasn't called us to fix everything in the world. He's called us to follow him. Amen. John 8:12. I'll be careful, this one's full on. Just put your seatbelts on. You might hit the Holy Spirit with this verse. Then Jesus spoke to them again, saying, I am the light of the world. He who follows me shall not walk in darkness, but have the light of life. You cannot walk in sin and darkness and be a slave of sin and say you're walking and following Jesus. He who follows me shall not walk in darkness. You can't, you know, God has not called us to be carnal Christians. To walk in darkness, to satisfy the flesh. Paul says, make no provision for the flesh. If you're addicted to porn, get rid of the internet. If television is a problem for you, give it away or throw it away. Or if you're in Texas, take your gun and shoot it. Praise God. John 10:27. My sheep hear my voice. You know, the shepherd in the New Testament, in the Bible, he went before his sheep and he called them. He didn't drive them. He would call them and he'd know them by name. My sheep hear my voice and I know them and they follow me. And I give them eternal life and they shall never perish. Neither shall anyone snatch them out of my hand. My Father who has given them to me is greater than all. He that is within you is greater than he that is in the world. I don't know what's wrong with some Christians. They're like, oh, I don't want to do deliverance ministry. I might get something. It's like, don't you know who you have? And no one is able to snatch them out of my Father's hand. My Father and I are one. I and the Father are one. Hallelujah. So he calls us. Mary, Bill, follow me. Just follow me. And when the Holy Spirit calls you, sometimes he says the simplest things. He's not trying to impress us. He says the simplest things. And sometimes it takes humility to obey the very simple things.
Come on.
You know, people, they want signs and wonders, but what Jesus wants is obedience. I remember I was in Queensland in a small country church with less people than are here today, and the Lord said to me, there's someone with a headache. So if you're looking for big things, you'll miss the big things. Someone with a headache. So Father says, yeah, that's my daughter, she suffers from headaches. And you can watch it on YouTube. And the girl, the back of her head, the skull is deformed and putting pressure on the brain. And that's why she had headaches. And they said one ear was lower than the other and the jaw was permanently locked. And they said to me, she's got a headache. And when it was rebuked, she fell out. She felt a band of heat go around her head and the skull grew out and the ear went up and the jaw was released. And all I knew was that she had a headache. The Lord didn't tell me anything else. Follow me. Don't follow him because of the glory, you know, because you want attention or, you know, or promotion. Or follow him because you love him.
Yes.
Just go where he goes and do as you're told. The servant is with the master. And all the master wants is that the servant is obedient in love. If you love me, you will obey my commands. John 21:20, one of the last sayings of Jesus. Peter, turning around, saw the disciple whom Jesus loved, it was probably John, following, who also had leaned on his breast at the supper and said, Lord, who is the one who betrays you? Peter, seeing him, said to Jesus, but Lord, what about this man? In life, your mind wants to understand things. What about this? Why did this happen? Why did I get sick? Why? What about this? When I get to heaven, I'm going to queue up and find out. And all this, the natural mind has all these questions. Jesus said to him, if I will that he remain till I come, what is that to you? Now, this is Peter, the apostle of the church in Jerusalem, who wrote some of the New Testament. Jesus' final words to him, some of the final words, you follow me. Now there you have the depths of the Christian walk. You follow me. We want to go deeper in the Lord. And he says, follow me.
Yes.
Praise God.
Yes.
And you cannot walk in darkness and follow him. The Bible says that righteousness goes before him. And righteousness goes before him and makes his footsteps our pathway. Did you hear that? Righteousness goes before him. It's righteousness that makes his footsteps our pathway. The way to follow Jesus is repentance. Walk in the light. Put your faith in him. Just trust him. Hold his hand. Keep going. I was in a town, country town in New South Wales, Australia, called Casino. I don't think there's a casino there, but that's what the town's called. And I said, Lord, do a new thing the day before. So I'm doing my thing. Normally I'm asking for a new thing and I'm doing my thing. So normally we put up a video clip of testimonies and I do my thing. But he decided to answer my prayer and do a new thing. And I didn't know what was going on. I felt frustrated. Funny, you know, I'm like getting angry with what God's doing, not knowing that God's answering the prayer. So we had a steam train whistle and it was blowing. Woo-woo! Just blowing for 20 minutes, on and off, on and off. There's a whole group of people who can testify, and the pastor. And I don't know what's going on. So I'm like, turn off the sound system. It's still going. And so I thought, for those who understand about sound, the guitar amp is normally separate from the sound system. So I said, turn off the guitar amp. And then it stopped. I thought, right, we got the problem. And then the other one started whistling. Woo-woo! All the kids are laughing, and people thought it was so funny, you know, and this train whistle in the building. There's no train in the town of Casino. So a week later, afterwards, a couple of days later, I began to understand that this was God. It took me a while to understand. And the Lord said to me, people, my people, people are on the platform and the train's there. And the Holy Ghost train is about to leave the platform. The whistle is blowing, but people can't move from the platform of sin. They're stuck in their unforgiveness, hatred, addictions, and they love them so much they won't get on the train. And the train is leaving without them. And God has a purpose, a beautiful purpose for their life and destiny. So let's just close our eyes. Jesus is looking at our hearts. He sees where we walk. He sees everything about us, and he loves us dearly. And he wants us to follow him, and he will give us eternal life. He calls us by name. So in your heart, choose to leave the things that hinder your walk with God. Let the dead bury their own dead. Let go of offense. Maybe there are things that are going on that, you know, people owe you money and that there's been injustice, court case. But does God want you to pursue it? Is that God's call on your life? Just follow Jesus. And you'll see those boxes just opening up and people's lives being blessed because you choose to forgive and love and follow the Lord Jesus Christ. In him there's abundant joy. In him there's peace. In him there's freedom. In him there's love. Amen.
Yes.
So just make that choice right now. I encourage you. Someone's offended you, just let them go. Thank you, Lord.
Since 1984, I've had horrendous problems with my neck.
You ready?
From a car accident, yes. My whole back.
You've got a disc and it's pushed to the left side. In the neck.
Mm-hmm. I do have a disc.
It's been pushed. It's out of alignment. That's the power of God coming on it. Okay, that's the power of God coming on it. That's the power of God coming on it. The mighty name of Jesus Christ. That's the power of God coming on it. That's the power of God coming on it. There it goes. It's loosening up, loosening up, loosening up. There it goes. It's coming back into place. That feels nice, Lord. That's the power of God on that. Okay, move your neck. How's that?
That's pretty good.
Is that all right now?
Mm-hmm.
You're fine. Yes. And just wait there. He's putting something around the bone. There's something spiritual going around the bone so that it won't come out again. Have you ever had any really good wine?
Yes.
Wine?
Thank you.
Now we're going to go to the best stuff. Lord, give her the best wine. The best wine.
My lower back, please.
Mm. You married? Not married. Were you married? You were married.
Thank you, Lord.
I'm seeing some problems in the guy. Hmm?
Yes. Right now?
No, back in when you were married to him. Is that right? He was demonized. I think the best description for him was that he was evil. So you need a healing of your soul, sister. Okay, just move away from the camera. You need a healing of your soul. And that's the mighty power of Jesus Christ doing that, okay? That's the mighty power of Jesus Christ healing your soul. You believe that Jesus Christ will do this? Hey? Yeah? That's the power of God coming on you. That's the power of God coming on you. The mighty name of Jesus Christ. That's the power of God coming on you. Power of God coming on you. Come on, get out. The mighty name of Jesus Christ. All of you, out! All of you, wherever you're hiding, out! In Jesus' mighty name. Okay, you're free. You're free. What did you feel happen? What did you feel happen? Hey? You've been wanting God to heal you.
I don't trust anybody.
Sorry?
I don't trust anybody. And it's hard.
You're okay, sister. Jesus has healed your heart. Okay? What do you want?
I have pain throughout my body, but it's mostly my left knee.
Okay, this is spiritual. It's spiritual. It's spiritual. The mighty name of Jesus Christ. Is power of God going through you? Power of God going through you? Power of God going through you? Okay, you're free. You're free. Move your limbs. Move your arms, your knees. Move, move, move. Can you move?
Oh, I can move. Thank you, yes. Jesus.
You're free. What do you want from the Lord?
My wrists, my carpal tunnel. My wrists, they feel like my hands, they hurt. I can't work.
Going back over your life, this is only one problem,
right.
But you've had numerous hindrances to your life.
Yes.
You get somewhere and you think that you're getting ahead, and then you fall back again.
Yes.
Your bank balance goes up. And you think, well, I can afford this, and then it goes, shh.
I can't afford anything.
But that's been the history of your life.
Yeah.
You have something, and then the enemy steals it.
Every time.
So this problem is not unique. It's a curse that's been operating, and that was operating in your parents, because your parents didn't move forward either. And I can hear your mum saying, you know, we never have anything. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ. You're free. It was a generational curse. And you're free. You're free. How's your hands going?
They don't hurt.
They don't hurt? They're normal now?
They always hurt.
They don't hurt now?
They don't hurt.
Amen. Jesus.
That was just a symptom of the generational curse. Yeah. Now that curse is gone, you can tick off lots and lots of things in your life, including your relationship with your parents. Are they living? Yeah, that's been set free. And I believe they are set free too.
I hope so.
They're set free too, all right? Was there a problem with alcohol with your father? Was there a problem with alcohol with your father? There was. So he's free. That's the power of Jesus Christ on your liver. So what's happening here is she's been located by the Lord to be an anointed servant. That's what's happening. Your liver's fine, sister. Your liver's fine. What's your name again?
Adrena.
Adrena. Just look at the camera. Adrena. So what happened right now?
When you were praying, you had prayed over me. You didn't even touch me or anything, but I had fell into this chair over here. And when I fell, I hit my tailbone. And 3 years ago, I went to a chiropractor, and he told me that my tailbone had been broken. And it happened around the age 11. I don't ever remember it, and I never went to the hospital for it. But when I was sitting here, the Holy Spirit said, touch your tailbone. And I touched the tailbone where it hit, and I don't feel that tailbone sticking out anymore.
So it was sticking out, was it?
Yeah, I could feel it usually if I put my hand right there, and I'm putting my hand right there, and it's not sticking out. I don't feel it.
How much was it sticking out by?
Enough to where I could feel it if I put my fingers there, and I don't feel the bone.
You don't feel it?
No. Just flesh back there. That's
you know, when I just agreed to come today, which was, we had like 2 days' notice about coming here, I felt the Lord saying that he had a specific purpose in coming. So I believe that you were part of that purpose, that he's anointed you to bring his healing power, the gospel, to people on the streets. And amen?
Amen.
Go for
Thank
it.
Thank you.
Follow
yes.
him.
Yes. Amen.
What's your name?
Gina.
Gina. What do you need from Jesus, Gina?
I've had like a demon or multiple mess with me, and I want to be restored to my mind, body, soul, and have a connection with Jesus.
That's the power of God going through you. What's your name, Gina?
Gina.
That's the power of God going through you. That's the Lord healing you. I wouldn't try to get up, sister. The anesthetic's real good. Just wait. Yeah. How's that?
Sweet. Oh, sweet.
It's sweet, is it? In what way is it sweet?
Just sweet joy.
Sweet joy. Have some more. There's some more coming your way. That's some more. I said, Melody, let the party begin. Amen. What was that?
Yeah, it's cool. It's great.
It's great, isn't it? Praise God. Hallelujah. Well, you're crying now, but you won't be for long.
Yeah, that's my mom.
That's your mom, is it? Yeah, she's being healed there.
She's been sick for a really long time.
She's been sick for a long time.
Yeah.
So these are tears of joy, are they?
Oh, so much. Oh, yes. I'm so thankful. Praise Jesus.
Praise God. You've been praying a lot for your mum, haven't you?
Yeah, every day.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Why do you think your mum got located first off the rank?
I'm not sure.
Because you've been praying every day for her.
I hope so, yeah.
Praise God. What do you need? Jesus. What's your name?
I'm Sierra.
Sierra.
Yeah.
What do you need from Jesus, Sierra?
Guidance for what he wants me to do with my life.
You are consecrated. What's your name again?
Sierra.
Sierra, you are consecrated. That means that you brought that consecration with you. You're like, what should I do with my life? But more important than what you should do is who you are, your identity. You are consecrated. Do you know what that means?
No.
It means that holy oil has been given to you from heaven before you got here that set you aside. All the vessels of the tabernacle were anointed. And when they were anointed, that could not be used for anything else. You have been anointed for Jesus.
For Jesus, yes.
Amen.
Amen, yeah.
So when you're considering what you should do with your life, remember that you're serving the Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Praise God, Sierra.
Thank you.
What's your mum's name?
Gina.
Gina, what do you feel happening down there, Gina? What's happening in your abdomen and what's happening?
Just like peace.
Peace.
Peace and bliss, joy.
Did you have pain before?
Pain, but extreme mental pain for 3.5 years, like from something.
Okay. I can't say touch your head.
Yeah.
I've gone through a lot of serious demonic oppression in the last like 2.5 years.
So let's wait on the Lord and see what he has to say, all right? What's your name?
Mike.
Mike. God loves you, Mike. Was there a man in your life who was quite strong, very influential over your life?
Yeah, my older brother.
Was he involved in some stuff?
Yeah, he was.
Because I'm seeing this man, and he's, I've got an echo, Sam, and he's quite a dominant figure in your life, and he was involved in some bad stuff. So,
yeah, was my older brother.
Sorry?
Older brother.
Yeah.
A little bit of my father.
So your problem comes from him. Okay. And that's the Lord Jesus Christ setting you free. He's burping. That's the evil spirits coming out of him. That's the evil spirits coming out of him. Thanks, Peggy. Coming out, it's coming out, it's coming out. Everyone pray, everyone pray, everyone pray, everyone pray. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Spit it out, spit it out. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Spit it out. There's more, come on, spit it out, all of it. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ. More's coming out. The mighty name of Jesus Christ. Praise God, you are free. What do you feel happen?
Just felt shaky all of a sudden, and just felt like stuff wanted to start coming up and out.
The spirit that was on, you're still being delivered of stuff, but the spirit that was on your brother was on you, okay? Because there was a strong man on your brother that had attached himself to you. So you had, you'd get severe anxiety, you'd get excruciating mental pain, hey?
Yeah.
So that's gone.
Amen. I receive it. I receive it.
You're free. Sister, you get a lot of negative thoughts. That these thoughts, I'm not talking to, no estoy hablándote, okay? These thoughts are trying to rob you right now from what God has for you. You understand what I'm talking about? Right now, you're having these negative thoughts. They're trying to steal from you what God has for you tonight, okay? You get rid of them. Tell the devil where to go. All right? Okay, come on. Come on. What's the problem? The mighty name of Jesus Christ. Come out. It's coming out of your gut. It's coming out of your gut. It's coming out of your gut. That's the power of Jesus Christ going through her. That's the glory of God surrounding her. The mighty name of Jesus Christ. Do you forgive? You forgive?
Yes, 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 I forgive.
You're free. You're free. What did you feel happen?
I don't know. It just says shaking. Shaking. All over.
You're free. How are you, sister?
Feeling better.
You're feeling better? What was the problem?
I had like horrible abuse as a child. Just, that was the problem.
That's what you thought was the problem, but you had a demon in your head.
Okay.
Yeah, that was what was tormenting you.
Okay.
What happened to you was an experience, but the demon that came probably through the experience is what was tormenting your life. Jesus Christ set you free. That's the power of God on you. That's the power of God on your leg.
Me quemé en las dos piernas. En las dos piernas, más que me duro mucho parada.
That's the power of God going. El poder del Señor está fluyendo por tus piernas. Okay, the power of God. She feels the power of God going through her. Se siente el poder del Señor. That's a spirit coming out of her. If you watch the eyes, you can see the spiritual battle going on. Okay. Muévete. Vení. Dale, 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 dale. Everyone say, dale, dale, dale. What does that mean? Go, go, go. Hallelujah. God is good, isn't he? Hallelujah. ¿Cómo está?
Bien.
¿Eh?
Bien, gracias.
Bien. Dale, dale, dale. Venga, 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 venga. Well, what do you need, Melody? Come.
Want the list? I have osteoarthritis, and I have a...
You ready? Yeah. That's the power of God coming on you. You believe that Jesus will do this? Yes. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Yes. Melody, talk to me about your mother. Your mother, Melody. Your mother, Melody. Talk to me about your mother, quickly.
My mother was she was a mean woman.
She was a bitter woman. And the spirit of bitterness from childhood went into your bones and caused that sickness. Bitterness rots the bones. This bitterness is not Melody's, it's from the mother. So you could say it's like a generational curse. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ. It's coming out of your melody. Everyone pray, everyone pray, everyone pray, everyone rebuke the sickness. Come on, get out. You come back for more. Oh, that's nice melody. Do you feel that? You feel that? What does that feel like?
It feels hot.
Oh, that's, I feel it nice and beautiful. She's got the heat, but anyway, praise God. Yes, that's lovely melody. Praise God. You'll go home, you say to your husband, let's go jogging. I'm feeling good. Praise God. Hallelujah. Want to hop up now? Okay. Did you have soreness before?
Yes, I did.
Okay, move around.
Yeah, my neck has hurt. My neck has hurt. I was told I couldn't eat all this stuff because of the arthritis.
Let's forget about that. How are you?
I feel good.
Move yourself. You want to get your kids to come up quickly? Get your kids?
I do.
Get your kids? You sometimes have a sluggish mind. That's the anointing against that sluggish mind. Sometimes it's just like it won't get into gear. Just relax, Mum. You're working too hard. There it goes. That's your IQ going up.
Oh,
I'm telling you, that's your intelligence just going up. That's the anointing. I tell people, there it is. That's your hearing going up. But I've never said that's your intelligence going up. Hallelujah. What do you say, Mum?
I think that's awesome. Thank you, Jesus. Yes.
Praise God. That's your brain surgery. Praise God. All right. Now, let me... What's your name?
Sophia.
Sophia, let me tell you something. The devil is a liar, and he's been telling you a heap of lies. Just read the word. You'll find the truth about yourself. Okay.
Yeah.
Yes. What was the problem, Melody?
My neck hurts, and my shoulders hurt all the time, and my hips.
Uh-huh.
And I was prayed for, and you got to the root of the issue.
Jesus did.
Jesus got to the root of the issue, right. Thank you, Jesus.
So what was wrong with you?
My neck hurt. My shoulders hurt.
How long?
About 5-6 years.
Did you say you had arthritis or something like that?
The doctor said I had osteoarthritis in my bones.
Did it hurt anywhere else?
Yeah, my hips and my knees.
So show us what you can do now.
I can move my head, I can move my shoulders and my knees. I feel good.
Who healed you?
Jesus.
Jesus, amen. God bless you, Melody. Yes?
My neck and my headaches all the time.
But from here to here, you get pain.
I hold my head to the side because my neck is kind of screwed up.
That's the power of God going down the back of your head. You had a problem with a stiff neck. I think you're okay, Ben. Move your neck. Move your neck. Move it this way. How you going?
Much better. It's much better. I couldn't really go both ways. My pain headache I've had for days, it's gone.
Okay, you're okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Where are you going? All right.
Okay.
Move your neck, your back. Look at that. Praise God. I can't believe it.
I can't believe my headache is gone.
What would you like Jesus to do for you?
I've been praying for a miracle. I need healing, and I think that I'm called in a ministry, but...
Look, we haven't got long. What would you like Jesus to do for you?
Deliverance.
It's coming out of her. It's coming out of her. This is a form of witchcraft. There was an object that was spiritually placed inside of her. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Princess, what was the problem?
Well, I have been struggling with a lot of spiritual issues, and I felt like I was going through deliverance. When I fell down on the floor, I felt like menstrual pain right on the lower side of my belly. And then while I was on the floor, I felt something rise up and come on my forehead, and it was hot. And then I felt like a sharp pain right in my stomach, and I was out, and I had spasm. My body was going all over the place, and some lady came and laid her hands on me and prayed over me. And after a little bit, when she lifted her hand off, I felt like heat come on my body, and I felt peace all over me.
So tell us a little bit more about the past and what the problem was.
In fact, while I was on the floor, I felt a lot of like commotion, a lot of confusion, a lot of chaos right in this part of my body. I've been experiencing a lot of spiritual attacks and stuff like that for years. Nothing goes right for me. I'm in chaos, a lot of fear. I feel like I've been struggling with a lot of bondage and all kinds of stuff.
So give us an example of a spiritual attack in your life.
Sometimes I just feel like heat rising on my body, and a lot of confusion and chaos and fear, a lot of fear. Like I just feel fear manifest in my heart, in my stomach, and a lot of fear and doubt in my mind, and a lot of like torment.
And how do you feel now?
I feel very peaceful.
Hallelujah.
Thank you. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus.
Who set you free?
Jesus did. Thank you.
Praise God.
Thank you.
Praise God. Yes, sir.
I was diagnosed by a couple doctors in emergency that I had diabetes, the pancreas quit, and I had high blood pressure, but mostly it's my legs feel like they're gone. I mean, they feel
Did
like
you used to drink?
Oh, yes, sir. I partied a
lot. I'm his wife.
You know all about it?
Yeah.
Yeah, we've been married 37 years.
The root of your illness is alcohol. Okay.
Okay.
God loves you. Your system is poisoned by the alcohol. God loves you. Diagnosis is healing. Okay?
Okay.
Just take your cap off. Yeah, bless you. God loves you. I see you. What's your name?
Ronnie.
Ronnie, I see you by yourself. Yes, with the bottle, but you're crying. You're just at the end of yourself. God loves you. But you're not alone. I see Jesus. Even with the bottle, everything, I see him. And he's got his arm around you. And he's calling you. Ronnie, Ronnie, I love you. I love you. I love you. You want to be free?
Yes, sir. Have everything.
Your father was an alcoholic, is that right?
Two of them.
I'm seeing you as a little boy sitting on a bench, and he was drinking, and then he'd pour some in a cup and give it to you.
I don't remember, but I don't doubt it. I started about a year ago. I started drinking again.
But a lot. Like
I just
years.
Felt that
mm. That's the generational curse of alcoholism coming out of him. That's the generational curse of alcoholism. That's a spiritual smack to demons. The mighty name of Jesus Christ. Your blood has been cleansed by the blood of Jesus. It's coming out of your ears, out of your eyes. Your organs are being cleansed. What do you feel happening?
I feel a cleansing of some kind and a lightness, a cleansing.
I feel
the blood of Jesus cleansed you. Now, what's the problem?
She had fear to come up here, but she's been dealing with fear, anxiety. She deals with a lot of anxiety. A couple years ago, she dealt with a suicidal spirit, and she was very scared.
You had a Barbie doll when you were a child.
¿Quieres que te hable en español?
Tuviste un, I don't know.
Una Barbie. Dice que tenías una Barbie cuando estabas chiquita, como una muñeca. ¿No te acuerdas de esa muñeca?
Tal vez, no.
She doesn't remember.
She had these dolls, but there was a Barbie doll. You created an imaginary world
of
dolls.
De muñecas.
And you wanted to become like them when you grew older.
Y querías ser como ellas cuando creciste.
Así comenzó tu problema. And you weren't able to be perfect.
Y no pudiste ser perfecta.
Like your dolls.
Como las muñecas.
You understand now?
¿Sí entiendes eso?
Then you began to worry about what other people thought of you.
Y lo empezaste a preocuparte qué es lo que la otra gente pensaba de ti.
That you weren't perfect.
Que tú no eras perfecta.
God loves you.
Pero Dios te ama.
Just like you are.
Así como eres, Dios te ama.
El poder del Señor está fluyendo sobre ti. Este es el poder del Señor. Está librándote de un mundo falso que tú creaste cuando eras nena. See how the Holy Spirit knows all about us. Look at me. Mírame. Tú eres libre. You are free. Okay? Give her a hug. Un abrazo. You know, God knows who you are. He knows who you are to be in Christ. You don't want to become something that the world made, because it'll lead you into bondage. Hallelujah. Everyone throw out their Barbie dolls. Amen. That's good. Hello to you. What's your name?
My name's Scott.
Scott. Praise God. Can I talk to you, Scott?
Yes.
You come from a good family.
Yes.
Come from a good family. You've been in church almost all your life.
Yes, sir.
You come from a good family. You've been in church all your life. You're married?
Yes.
I can see you're a good husband. You're faithful. You're the breadwinner. Put food on the table, roof over the head, you know, you're good. But there's a problem with an atmosphere of religion. And Jesus Christ is setting you free today. You're a good man, but the religion is not helping you. Everyone say, you're a good man.
You're a good man.
But religion's not helping you.
Amen.
What do you need from the Lord?
I need a healing from pancreatic cancer.
Mm-hmm. You want to be a prayer helper in the green down the back? Yeah. You have seen the Lord do some healings and things throughout your life.
Yes. Yes. Lots of them.
Yeah. What type of things have you seen?
Cancer healed, skin cancer on the side of somebody's face, almost 100% blind in one eye. And within 2 days, he was completely healed,
fully restored.
Where's the pancreas? Okay, we're going to put your hand here.
Okay.
Praise God. That's the power of God coming on you. You just stand there in faith, Sophie. That's the power. Oh, that's the power of God coming on you. Oh, she's gone. That's the power of God on you. You can keep your hand on her tummy. That's the power of God on you. That's the spirit coming out of you. The spirit of cancer coming out of you. The spirit of cancer, get out. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Come on, get out. Do as you're told. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ. You unclean spirit, get out. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Sister, do you believe that Jesus Christ will do this?
Sister, do you believe that Jesus Christ will do this?
Oh, thank you, Jesus. Yes.
Talk to me. Do you believe that Jesus Christ will
do this? Yes, I do.
Yes. Is this demon saying, she doesn't believe, I'm not going? That's it. That's it. That's the glory going into you. That'll feel nice. That's the glory going into you. Oh, that's the power of God around that cancer. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Father. Come on, get out. That's the glory of God around the cancer. Glory of God around the cancer. Glory of God moving around the cancer. You'll start feeling that. That's the glory of God moving around the cancer. Thank you, Jesus. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. That's heaven breathing on you. Heaven breathing on you. Breathing life. 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 Praise God. You want to hop up now? What do you feel happening, sister?
I have no pain. Thank you, Jesus. I believe in you, Jesus.
To get a touch from the Lord is so good. Sing. To get a touch from the Lord is so good. If you draw nigh to Him, He will draw nigh to you. To get a touch from the Lord is so good. Quickly, Melody, come. Give me your left hand.
Oh. Oh.
Thank you, Jesus.
Oh, oh God, amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Oh. Oh. Oh, thank you. Oh, my. Oh, thank you. Thank you. Oh, oh,
Oh, hallelujah, Jesus. Oh, God.
What do you feel happening?
Oh, thank you,
what do you
Jesus.
Feel happening?
What do you feel happening?
Oh, it's gone. It's gone. It's gone. Hallelujah, Jesus. Oh, amen.
Now.
Yes.
I want you to go.
Yes.
And have something to eat. Go and eat, okay?
Now?
At the end of the meeting, all right?
Yes.
Okay?
Yes.
All right. The first time I was watching the evil spirit leaving, the second time I was watching Jesus putting stuff in you. Okay?
Thank you.
Like things have been removed and putting organs or whatever in there, okay?
Thank you, Lord.
Now, you had pain before? Before
yes.
you had pain?
Yes.
Now, push yourself. Push hard.
Amen.
What do you feel happening now? Any pain?
And I feel clear.
What does that mean?
What does it mean? I feel clear. I am not worried.
God
because
bless you.
The Lord Jesus Christ has healed me.
Amen.
And I believe in the Lord Jesus Christ. And hallelujah.
Amen. Amen. So, could you feel any tumors or anything like that?
Don't feel any.
Could you feel them before?
Yeah, I was hurting when I came in tonight.
Okay, so press, can you feel anything in there now?
No.
Someone lift your hands to Jesus and say thank you to Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
Forget about clapping, just lift your hands to him.
Thank you, Jesus.
And give him praise. I love you, Lord. Give him praise. And I lift my voice to worship you, O my soul. Rejoice. Take joy, my King, in what you let it be a sweet, sweet sound in your ear. What would you say to someone who's got cancer? What would you say to them? What spiritual advice would you give?
Get closer to the Lord. Praise Him. Pray to Him daily, every moment of the day.
Amen. Heather, this is your boy?
Yes,
sir. Hi. Yes. What does he need?
He's had allergy problems for a long time, really long time. So we've seen it leave before, and then it's come back. And we want to see it gone completely. So.
Praise God. So, he's been taught to be good and he's been disciplined, is that right? Yeah. But what can I say? He's learnt to almost be too good, you know? See, when I put my hand on him, he's like this, because I have to be good. I don't want to fall over or do anything that's wrong. So it's become a resistance to the anointing because of his upbringing.
Yes.
What happened?
I've made mistakes, you know, and in loving him, it's almost put him into a perfectionism, and he's not supposed to be there. He's supposed to be free.
So they've come with presenting need of, what was it?
Allergies.
Allergies. Yeah. But Jesus so loves him that he's revealing a perfectionism that's ungodly.
Right.
So that if this is not dealt with when he gets married, he'll have an ungodly perfect expectation of his wife and his children, and it becomes a generational curse. You see? Praise God. Hey?
He's a good boy.
I know. He's probably the best. All right, I got something for you to do. All right, what's your name?
David.
Go home and get muddy.
That's easy.
Okay.
Yes, I did.
I'm having a vision. Go and get muddy, all right? Make a mess of your clothes. Mom can wash them. That's it coming out of you. Breathe in again. It's the power of God going into you. See, only Jesus would know all that.
Right.
Jesus is thinking about his future, years down the road, and his relationships, and that he needs to get muddy. And don't worry about banging up your bicycle. All right?
Oh, dude, that's gonna be bad.
Hey? It's so right, yeah.
How's that
yeah,
so right?
He just got his new bike, and he's worried about messing it up because he's afraid that he won't ever get another one. And
so Jesus says, don't worry about scratching it, okay?
Well, it's already too muddy. If it scratches it, I'll just take the mud off.
Uh-huh. All right. So what's his name again?
David,
just relax and enjoy life.
Yeah.
And don't worry about your bike and everything else, all right? Just enjoy, all right?
Okay.
God loves you, okay?
Yeah.
Praise God. Let's just pray once more. And just relax when I pray for you, right?
Okay. Good.
How are you going?
I'm doing good.
You're doing good.
Yes. I feel very good.
How's okay.
Free.
How'd
you feel very free. I don't have a care in the world.
Not a care in the world. Go and sit and make mud cakes and scratch your bike. Okay?